Welcome. Welcome to Grassroots TV, the oldest community access station in the USA, right here, high up in the Rockies where the good vibrations go. And we are having a wonderful time, and I have a very special guest. I can't wait to introduce her. We've been friends for a long time. She's been in Aspen. She's traveled all over the world. I want you to give a warm round of applause to Sarah Pletts, Aspen's local artist. Right? Let's welcome local artist.
Such a big job. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, geez. Yeah, you've been really, you've done a lot of stuff. Oh, and also we got to welcome Macaroni and, of course, Pee Wee over here. That's my boy. And that's about, what's he doing? He's scratching his ears?
Yeah, he's making sure he's listening.
That's right. He's going, I'm listening here like, well, what'd you say? Okay. Well, Sarah, let's get rolling here. Where do we begin? Let's go. How long have you been in Aspen?
Let's see. 3 days and 4 hours. Well, no, I was down in Down Valley. My home has been here going on 40 years.
40 years. Wow.
Amazing,
you're,
huh?
You're like a real local here. You have a studio here,
mm-hmm.
and you have also been instrumental in doing performing arts.
Yes.
You have a dance studio.
Uh-huh.
You've taught dancing here. You've taught performing arts, and I would say, and you're also an artist, a painter, right?
Yeah, visual artist. I'm a multimedia artist.
You're multimedia. Mm-hmm. I understand. I can relate to that. It's fun. We got to keep ourselves busy, right?
I guess.
That's what I have to do. I got journals, you know, and I keep myself busy. Well, Sarah, what are you up to right now?
Let's see. It is August 2017, according to the Roman calendar. I have a show. I'm selling a lot of my visual art from the last 40 years. That's at my studio at 410 North Mill Street. It's in the North Mill Artists Association building. Jim Horowitz is in that building. There's several architects. We've been artists over there for going on that building, going on 30 years. We changed the zoning, and my mom and I did that and put artists in the zoning.
Talking about changing things, let's real quick, let's see, you know the date of it? I mean, how far back did we go? Remember when we were performing around town?
Mid-80s.
Mid-80s, and the city wanted to pass, wanted everybody to have a permit. And
well,
you dressed up
unfortunately,
as a,
there was an artist on the mall, and I think he used a cuss word in front of a child, which is an issue. But there was an overreaction. It's kind of, from my perspective, when you're afraid of something, it happens in the political arena, it happens in the community arena. We can have a whatever response we choose. Well, some of the businesses weren't that happy with arts blocking their way. We needed to all talk and communicate. But instead of doing that, at first, the city tried to enforce a licensing law for street performers, which is actually in violation of the freedom of speech. So don't you remember, Hinton, you and I went to the meetings, and I had been in Los Angeles.
City council meeting, right?
Rehearsing city council meeting, and I had been in Los Angeles, and just by chance, it was the spirit of my grandmother beckoned me into a little shop. It was a costume shop, and I found a Statue of Liberty, the headpiece and the torch, and a dress, and brought it back, and just so happened I needed it. So I wore the Statue of Liberty around town, and
I remember I took a photo of it for you.
Yeah, and perhaps we can take a look at it sometime. But it was worth it. It was a lot of effort, but I think the council came to see that it was not the right thing to do. And then we all talked, and the business people asked the music students to shift over, and I mean, we love the art on the streets in Aspen.
Well,
right?
it would have been an inconvenience to all the music students, I mean, for sure. I mean, you think about how many music students show up here in the summertime and they play on the street, which I think is a great gift to the community. You know, and I think that's one of the magical, beautiful things about Aspen, and so, you know, such a beautiful environment, and that, you know, to have the music student playing, you know, playing classical music.
Right.
That was an asset. I mean, you want that, you know. So yeah, right. Thanks to you, give me fun. You did you're such a brave and courageous artist.
Thank you.
And together, but I was just beside you because you were the, you know, the person who put the energy into it, and that was wonderful, and changed things for all of us. And actually, but what came out of that, one of the things was really cool was that we were able to, artists were able to be recognized, you know, it was a job, you know, right. I mean, like to be, you know, if you worked in Aspen, you know, to get some of the benefits of like maybe, you know, being a local or housing or things like that. You had to work so much time, right? And that initiated putting artists in the working list, I guess you would
call it. Right, and that's what we did at the North Mill Artists Association. We have a job like everyone else does. You know, I wanted to talk about, I bought this blouse. I'm wearing it in my hometown of Aspen, Colorado, but I bought it in Italy. And I was thinking this morning about my first, because I work there a lot. And what I love about there and bringing that back to here is making space for the arts. People used to say to me years ago, why do you go to Italy? And I would say, because it's recognized as a job. We're right in there with the plumbers and the electricians.
Right.
But that's here now. I mean, arts as a viable economic force. I mean, Mom and I and Cy Coleman and other people in town spent years and years meeting with ranchers and locals and store owners and retailers and business people that also make this community incredibly viable. And, you know, that's how we built an arts community.
Another give me five. That was another wonderful thing, you know, recognizing artists, art as a business. You know, artists could be...
This building... There was a group of us that got the Red Brick Center for the Arts on the ballot.
There you go.
And then after it passed by 3 votes, I sat out front there with my card table and collected signatures. I remember one day, one guy walked up and he said, there were some folks next to me and they had bigger cars and better lunches and fancier tables. And then there was me at the card table. And this man in a lovely suit, he looked at one group and he looked at me and he said, I want to hear your version too. And he came over and signed the petition. Then the most interesting thing, and I want to talk about my mom, Janet Garwood, who was also president of the Arts Council for a while. She's 90, still alive, little frail, but doing okay. After it passed, this Red Brick Center, then the city was reluctant. They couldn't see how to financially fill it with all these wonderful artistic businesses. So Mother, Janet Garwood, Bob Camp, Rachel Richards, and I'm sure others.
How about Sterling? Worked. Was he around then? Bill Sterling, did he have anything?
I don't know. You know, he had so many other things to do at the time.
Right.
They worked with the city manager and finance for a year and a half, pushing the numbers to get it renovated. You know, it takes a lot of effort, and for those of you out there, that want to see and continue the arts as a cultural commitment. Speak up.
That's right. And thanks to you, you did that. And you've been very, you're persistent, and you've continued to bring, you know, great contributions to the community. So where are we now? What would you like to talk about? Because you got a lot going on. I mean, you're a versatile person, and you travel around the world, and you're in New York. Didn't you do a play in New York?
I did.
Right. And you're still, is that there now? Or are
well,
you still
no.
Doing it?
It ran for a few weeks. We got a grant at the Stella Adler Theater in Manhattan. My play is called Henry's Letters. And it's about the legacy of Henri Matisse passing color to my painting teacher at Pratt Institute in Brooklyn, and then to myself and dozens, if not hundreds, of other students. He taught at Pratt for 30 years. And then about us passing it to the next generation. So that's what Henry's Letters is about.
Fantastic. And now you have a exhibit, your own artwork, you're in your studio.
Uh-huh. And by the way, the studio is called the Living Arts Studio.
Living Arts, that's what I was trying to get from you. Sarah created the Living Arts Studio, and it's been going on for as long as you've been here, right?
Almost, yeah. We were able to rezone for zoning for artist studios in the mid-'80s. It was either 83 or 85, I can't remember. It's been an art studio. I mean, I was thinking of Dick Keenis the other day, because he took acting in that studio with me, you know, and all different kind of folks from town, studying speech, acting, art, drawing, lots of things.
Yeah, and you put on performances. You had shows regularly. You would put on, and you had some of your students perform with you.
Correct? Oh, yeah, uh-huh.
Yeah. I remember that. And
big stars. Uh-huh. Big stars like you also. Oh, uh-huh. I remember one of the older Aspen Art Museum, the concertmaster for the symphony here, Ruben Gonzalez, fantastic violinist, world-renowned. He wanted to be in it, and he played a circus barker and stood on a box in the art museum. He was so happy. It was his acting debut. So I love it when the different organizations in town collaborate and cross the genres.
I do too, and I love that fact that you're here today with me, and we're talking and sharing our memories. So what else would you like to share with us?
Well, didn't you want to do a little routine there?
You think we ought to do? I was thinking maybe we could end it with it or something.
Oh, we'll get them all excited. Stay tuned. Right. Don't get up and go get your pizza. There's something really good coming. Okay. Well, we used to do that. Remember that?
Uh-huh. Yeah. We used to do that little, I'm going to.
Oh, dear. It hurt me instead. Oh my goodness.
I got that from the circus. When I was in a circus, I was a clown, and we did a boxing routine, and two clowns come out, and we're boxing each other. We're posing, you know. We're getting.
It's your fault.
I beat myself up. That's kind of like life, isn't it? We're always beating ourselves up. Well, let's see, Sarah, we could talk about anything you want to talk about. Anything else going on? I mean, you're going to be in town for a while?
A little bit longer.
A little bit longer.
Almost to the end of August. I get to be here for a whole month this year. I'd like to be here more, but I'm my mom's primary caretaker right now.
And so where's she?
She's down on the Gulf Coast of Florida.
Yeah, wow, that's nice. You go down there in winter?
I am. I'm hoping to get a job. I'm applying to teach painting and illustration at the Ringling College in Sarasota. Oh. Hey, that's kind of a double link for us because...
I went to Clown College. But it wasn't in Sarasota. Back then it was in Venice, Florida. That's where the winter headquarters were for the blue and the red unit. There were two units. I was in a blue unit as a clown, Ringblows, and toured around the U.S.
Amazing.
Yeah,
amazing.
It was great school. I mean, it was the best school I've ever gone to. I learned so much from that school.
Yeah, well, there's two schools. There was the circus school, and then now there's the College of Art and Design.
Good.
John Ringling was something. He had quite a forward thinking in the arts.
Yeah. I don't know where the archives are for the circus, but if you're there, you know, look into this because they have an incredible film library. And we got to look at all the films when I was going to Clown College, and it's amazing to look at the history of the art and go back to the street artists, especially during the Depression. There was some of the most incredible talent you could imagine. Imagine how competitive it would have been when people were trying to, raise enough money to eat. You know, so you saw some incredible talent, and of course Irving Feld and Kenneth Feld. Irving Feld owned the circus, and then Kenneth Feld inherited it, and now Ringling Brothers is gone because. The animals. Without the animals, I guess people are not interested in it.
Right, because we have a different relationship to animals. But because of that foundation, this Ringling College of Art and Design is leading in animation of all things.
Cool.
Yeah, so I'm going to be teaching, hopefully, painting and illustration. And the film I wrote about my dad, Related Strangers, when she has a hard time with certain things, she likes to imagine like a an aggressive person comes up and she imagines they have an alligator head. You know, it's like, ooh, what do I do with the alligator? So I might, if I'm teaching illustration, get a chance in my 60s to do a little animation because that's something they're famous for. But I want to talk about the learning here in the Roaring Fork Valley now, because I just ran into somebody taking a really good course at Anderson Ranch. And one of the things that's come out of building a culturally based community here, thank you, Elizabeth Pepka. Okay, you too, Walter. But really, Elizabeth Pepka. Wow. One woman.
Yeah.
One phenomenal woman.
Think about the music.
You know, 1949. For the Germans, because the world was pretty upset with Germany. And Elizabeth said, hey, there's a lot of good German people, including Goethe, and we're doing a music festival. And that really, you know, started this whole other renaissance. I mean, some of the folks sort of, you know, are still doing art indigenously here, and, you know, that's a whole other issue. But I am very grateful to the Pepkas, especially Elizabeth.
I understand, and I can appreciate them, too. It's just fascinating. I was at the Historical Society, and I listened to their little routines about the history of Aspen, and it's just amazing how it evolved into what it is now,
right.
You know, and all the culture we have here, and you know, and with the music and the arts and performances and the ballet and the Wheeler Opera House and well, you know, all that conversion, and I'll turn it into an amazing opera house, and it's you know, it's interesting how it attracted intellectuals. I mean, you think about with the Physics Institute and the Aspen Institute, the sciences and all that. And then, of course, you have the film festivals. And we have Sarah and, you know, all these
and
amazing
Hinton.
People. All these amazing people that come to Aspen. Aspen is a real magnet, isn't it?
I mean, yeah, it's just, and there is something that I would like to talk about in terms of when something gets rolling like this. We were here a lot for the starting the engine, right? And it took a lot of effort.
Right.
I mean, you know, Elizabeth had her phase and kept on through the end of her life. Then there was a whole other phase in the 70s, 80s, and the turn of the millennium, you know. And now, whenever something starts to sort of be too happy with itself, you know, we have to watch out for something else, which is to stay present and alive. Because a lot of the composers, the young composers and conductors have been coming over to my studio this summer, Saturday night soirees. It's been really fun. And I'm listening to them talk about the change, because some of them come for many years, and the change, because we're talking about teaching now. And so we have a lot of students coming from around the world studying music. And last night in my studio, there was a pianist, Sean from Ireland, who lives in Amsterdam, and Harry, a violinist from Australia. They're very happy to be here. And they were talking about the pianist gets to study. He gets to be in the class, in the master classes with extraordinary teachers, and reflect on the growth of his own art. The violinist, however, is very utilized in the concerts and sometimes works 6 hours a day studying his violin day after day. Doesn't really have time to hike, doesn't have time to reflect. So we were talking last night about the difference in those two situations. And we don't, because we get to a certain level of success, we don't want to, in the violinist's case, stop the learning and reflection. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, of course.
And so that's something that's changed. Once, even here at the Red Brick, you know, we have to stay vigilant about giving our artists time to reflect and to be themselves.
Right. Well, I love it when they go out on a street and perform. I mean, that's a real, you know, I would think that's kind of being able to, you know, be in nature in some way, you know, I mean, to have that music, you know, ambiance in the streets. You know,
and the plein air artists this summer, too, out painting.
Yeah, with that, too. Let's I want to ask you another question, and that is, aren't you writing a book, or didn't you? Are you working on a book?
I am. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, and how's that going?
Well, I've got two. One is further along, and it's called Arthur's Mother.
Uh-huh. That's an interesting title.
Thank you. It's about the man that we have been calling King Arthur, but my research is suggesting that he was neither a warrior nor a ruler. He was, such as yourself, a man of the light. So anyway, I've been collecting books on it for years, and I'm on my third draft. In fact, I was at a writer's conference in Wales, and Colm McCann, my friend, the Irish writer, he said, Sarah, you're working on something, asking us to think that maybe the way we learn things weren't the way they happened. He embarrassed me. I wasn't ready to be up in front of the British intellectual audience yet. So anyway, I'm working on that. Arthur's Mother. One man actually said to me, Arthur had a mother? Yeah, imagine that. He didn't pop out of a football smoking a cigar.
He wasn't hatched like an egg or anything. Yeah, well, you know, you just made a point, too, about everything is open for interpretation and often lost in translation. So everybody, you know, has their insight into this, creating a story, I guess, a narrative, a theme, you know. What's the other book?
Well, I may do one that goes with my dad's film, but the other one I've been working on.
Oh, you're doing a film? Got a film going on, too.
Yeah.
All right.
A feature film.
Is it a documentary or a narrative film drama?
It's a dramatic piece about the flower child and the naval pilot, my dad and me.
Aren't we right now in the summer of love or something? I mean, you said flower.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, it's like so. Well, that's good. You're busy. See, you got a lot going on. You got a lot of irons in the fire, and when I bring them out, brand and make a mark. You're always doing incredible things. So we got the movie going, we got the book going, we got the performance, and we got the art. And that's the thing we really want to mention is that she's got an exhibit. Right,
an
of your
exhibit
art.
In
and
my
they might
studio.
Be able to show one of your pictures. I think we'll slip it in there.
Good.
Yeah, and.
And in this case, Jeremy's the curator. He's picking the shot.
So good. Well, maybe we just get to the point. Maybe you want let's do. You want to do a little skit or something? We were talking.
Oh my God! You're going to put me to work.
Pee-wee, move over. Listen.
Pee-wee, move over. Okay, here we go.
All right. Are you ready? We've always talked about doing this because Sarah's always going, "Hey," and
I
we're
know.
Both like an elderly couple now and. We're, you know, let's pretend we're driving down the road, okay? Are you ready? And so here we go.
But there's only one steering wheel. Oh, I have to be the passenger, okay.
Well, hang in there. I might just give you the steering wheel after a while, you know? So we're driving down the road. And it's like...
Can you... Oh, watch out!
What is it? What is it? Oh, no!
You missed it by accident. Huh? Oh, my God.
What happened? I did I miss that tree? Look out. Here
that
we go.
That tree is so happy.
Am I going down the right lane? Am I on the right side of the road? Where are we? Where do we drive? On the right or the left side of the road? What? What'd you see?
I'm not going to say.
What is it?
It's horrible.
What is it?
I'm not saying.
Should I drive faster? Should we stop? Is there something?
No, you did it. You got me past it. You got me past it.
Go past it? What is it? A roadkill?
It was a...
Uh-oh, that sounds... It was a what? Oh, my goodness, that's disgusting. Why didn't you warn me about that?
I tried.
Here, you know what? I'm getting tired of driving. I think you should drive because I'm too old to drive. I can't drive anymore. Here, you take the steering wheel. I'm going to just sit over here.
This is a very cool car. You can switch sides.
Yeah.
Are we in England now?
Yes, we are.
Oh,
we're driving down the road in
England on the other side. Oh, I see. I better pay attention.
Well, you know what? Let's just keep driving and we'll just drive all through Europe and we'll go from, you know, through the English, the English Channel or something? You can drive under the water now. We'll go to Paris and we'll go to Amsterdam. We'll go to Holland and we'll go down and... Let's see, where else could we go? Let's just hang out in Holland. Let's hang out in Amsterdam. I think Amsterdam sounds like a fun city. What do you say?
Tulips?
Yeah, tulips.
Tulips.
Tulips, and they got those windmills, and they have. You know, they get high. Like we here in Aspen, we just go high up in the Rockies, but in Holland, they just they stay low.
In the theater in Amsterdam, but not in London, you smoke pot and get high. The trouble is, if you really want to hear the script, you have to cover your nose in the lobby. Because other people are smoking pot, and you're like, oh, I didn't want to see that show, Stone.
Okay, Sarah, I think we're coming to the end of the... Uh-oh, there's a doggy barking. What's a doggy barking
at? I put the steering wheel down, and look what happened. Max is
Pee-wee,
now driving.
Where's my Pee-wee? Come over here, Pee-wee. Pee-wee should drive. All right, thank you very much. We want to thank... Let's see, what am I doing? Am I talking to a camera? To that one there? All right, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. This is Sarah Pletts, and I'm Hinton Harrison, and we're at Grassroots TV here in Aspen, high up in the Rockies, and we want to thank you. We're just having fun, that's all. I'm trying to reminisce on some of the memories we've had together. Oh, thanks for the memories.
So and we're still going strong. We got years ahead of us.
Bye-bye. Drive safely.